We're going to get started with the ideation phase. And with that, I would like to welcome additional members of our team to the stage: Paul Brown, Bill Lewis, Paul Bevan, Ron P., and Ganesh Sethuraman. So, Bill.
Thank you, Jim. Good afternoon, everybody. So, what I want to do is take some time to walk you through how the digital twin will help us develop a smart product. But before I do that, I want to back up a little bit and do a level set and talk about what makes up a smart product. What is a smart product? You know, there's a lot of examples that we see in the news every day in our lives that we interact with. You know, some of the obvious ones are autonomous vehicles. That's one of the ones that we hear about all the time. Drones that are going to deliver packages or pizzas or whatever the case might be, all the way to the washing machine that you use to wash your clothes that weighs the clothes and flops them around a little bit before it determines how much water and how much energy to use. These are all examples of smart products, and they have some common characteristics across all of them. One of the things that you see with smart products is that they have kind of eyes and ears and that they can observe their environment with. They can get input from what's happening around them, and they can use that information to then determine and change their behavior and self-regulate what they're doing based upon that input. So they can change based upon the conditions of the environment that they're in. Now, another common aspect of a lot of these things is they're connected. You know, if you think about the example of a GPS, the GPS experience of getting you from point A to point B really isn't just about the device that you have in your hand, but that GPS is part of a system of systems. It interacts with satellites. It has data connections that download maps and traffic information, and it all works together to give you the experience of getting where you need to go. So they're connected. And then finally, as you can imagine, they're all mechatronics driven. They're all implemented in some way with a combination of mechanical, of course, but also electronics, like we've talked about, and also software. And all those things need to come together effectively to really deliver the experience that you're looking for with your smart product. Now, what are some of the keys to developing a smart product, a product that can do these sorts of things? Well, one of the first things you need to be able to do is develop an unambiguous definition of the product. What do I mean by that? I mean, you understand what the product is supposed to do. You understand what the systems and subsystems that are going to interact are and how they're supposed to interact. You've clearly documented that for everybody to understand. You also then need to effectively manage a multi-domain implementation. So how are you going to make sure that your software and your electronics and your mechanical are developed in such a way that they're going to work together naturally? And then finally, how are you going to prove that the product does what you think it's supposed to do? You know, you've laid out plans, but how are you going to make sure that you close the loop, simulate that product virtually, and take any lessons that you learn and feed it back into the process so you can make it better the next time? So we're going to walk through an example today of demonstration that does this for us. Now, the example we're going to do today is going to take a largely mechanical system. In this case, it's going to be a landing gear, sticking with our aviation theme. A landing gear and a door system for the landing gear. And that's, right now, is a mechanical system that's basically operated in one continuous movement that opens the doors, drops the landing gear, and closes the doors. And then when it's time for that landing gear to come back up, that landing gear is, again, one continuous infrastructure that opens the doors, pulls the landing gear up, and then closes the doors again. Now, the system that we found, or the situation we found ourselves in, is that we're getting an obstruction in the door that may cause a jam. And I know you guys have an acronym for what that means. I don't remember what that acronym was. But it could be debris. It could be something that gets in that door that prevents it from closing. But like I said, that's all one mechanism. So if we keep trying to close that door while it's obstructed, we're going to break things. We're going to deform the mechanism and make it not work. So we want to avoid that. So first, we're going to go through a mechanical solution. We're going to take a corrective action to fix that. But then later, we're going to smarten up the whole system so we can avoid the problem in the first place. Introduce the things like the sensors. They're going to make sure that it's not having a collision and so forth. And then add all the mechatronic implementation to make sure we can modify the behavior. So in order to get started, I'm going to hand it over to Paul, and he's going to walk us through the beginning portions of our demo.
Okay, thanks, Bill. So what we'd like to do is we want to take you through the process of how we would look and analyze if we had this foreign object damage to the mechanism. So if we just look at this, and the whole idea is really, the first thing we want to do is bring simulation to the fore. Start analyzing the behavior, not wait and try and test something out. The last thing we need to do is physically test this. We really want to get the material that we can use for FAA certification and that documentation. So the whole idea of simulation for us in this cycle is to evaluate the problem and get the answer. Now, I'm pleased that we've been joined on stage by Ganesh. Ganesh is going to take us through the demonstration. I'm going to narrate through, so if we can just move over and display Ganesh's screen. So we're in the mock-up of the Eclipse aircraft. We're going to drill down to the front landing gear. Now, as Bill mentioned, the front landing gear, we've seen that we have the potential for a jam based around, you know, say, foreign object damage. So what we're going to do is run that through the mechanism, and you'll get a chance to see the example as we go through. So what Ganesh is going to do is show you that cycle in motion. It's pretty neat the way it works. So you'll notice as we drive the trunnion, we pull the trunnion back up into the inside the aircraft. You'll notice the doors will open, and we'll go through and we'll drive that through. So we're going to go through the motion. Now, one of the things that we want to do is look at the displacement of the arm. And in the middle of this, you can see this yellow rocker arm. Now, this yellow rocker arm is really key, because what it's going to do, that's what's going to be connecting and actually is driving the doors back open and closing. So if we run the animation sequence now, Ganesh, then we can go through, and you can see as the doors open, the trunnion's coming up, the wheel's coming up, the doors are opening, and then they will close back down again. You can see it on the graph as we go looping around. Now, we've introduced this actual, jam that stops the doors from closing completely. You can just about see the jam. One of the doors is slightly ajar. So what you can see, now what that's actually doing, because the system was trying to close up completely, it's increasing the forces on that arm. So the bottom graph is actually the forces on that yellow bell crank as we go through. And you can see that that's causing us a problem. You know, we can look at, we can zoom in a little bit more on those, Ganesh, and actually see the displacement and where, how they're working. So we're going to go through that. What Ganesh has done is he's going to move those loads from that motion analysis into a finite element analysis to do a small structural analysis on this bell crank. And you can start seeing this over time, the way that the forces are applied to this part. And what you're seeing, slightly different to the other graphs, what you're seeing is left and right, basically the forces on the two pivot points as you go forward. So what Ganesh is actually doing is he's ascertaining what the maximum forces are on those. So we're doing we're taking the results from the motion and then doing a time-based stress analysis around this part. So we can actually start seeing the maximum minimum loads on that bell crank. Now that's going to be important to us, because what we want to do is design and make sure our design is robust enough to meet that that condition. So if we get this door jam, if foreign object gets in there, stops the doors from closing, that we actually can physically not break the part. Now we're also going to, as Bill mentioned a bit later on, introduce some smarts into the system, some actual sensors that allow us to control what happens when this situation occurs, but we still need the part to be strong enough. So one of the key things here is that, you know, being able to do that and go through analysis. Now, another form of the analysis really is to look at how the air is going to flow. So thanks for that, Ganesh. Let's look at how the air is going to flow through this. So if we can come back to the slide. So what you can now see is we're going to take you through one of the, Tony mentioned the acquisition of CD Adapco on one of their products of Star CCM Plus. This is an analysis. This is actually showing you the air velocity, as in you can see the turbulence that the flying with the wheel down, with the flap open, is causing. Now, we've also got an example. This has actually got the door slightly jammed open, and you can see the air coming back up into the cavity where the wheel's tucked in and running underneath. So it gives us a much higher fidelity, much higher confidence, which we can then use for the FAA regulations to actually show and prove that, you know, that the capacity that we've designed into this product and that the aircraft is safe to fly.
So Paul, can I just interrupt just for a second? Because I wanted to ask Alan if some of this rings true to some of the things that you see in the actual development environment and really the in-service environment right. that your customers experience.
So it does very much so. Obviously, when you look at the airflow and the turbulence on it, you can imagine both a lot of drag, but it's also destabilizing on the airplane. So these are things you have to look at ahead of time. But interestingly, and this presentation's obviously been in the works for a while, a little over a week ago Saturday, I was at an air show in California, met with a customer of one of our very early Cirrus products, my first design. And he had exactly this problem. We believe it was a towing accident. The door was bent slightly. The door closed before the gear. Fortunately, didn't jam the gear. He was able to get the gear down. And what it really pointed to was 30 years ago when we didn't have this, an inadequate design. We didn't have enough stiffness in the push rod and the bell crank that did it and allowed it to flex just far enough that you could get this interference in the wrong situation. So obviously a very practical and necessary tool, both for how we use it in designing airplanes going forward, but in how we look at the safety factors afterwards. The nose gear isn't the most critical of the wheels if it doesn't come down, but it's obviously still a life-threatening situation, and this is the kind of thing that directly affects safety and utility.
Thank you. Okay, so hopefully what you can see, one of the real values for the simulation tools is really to understand the scale of the problem.
I just thought of one other point I should add, just because it's funny, it sticks in my head. We need to do some acoustical analysis as well, because it turns out that his door is stuck partly open as a result of this accident, and he says it whistles in flight. So.
I'm sure we can help you with that one. Okay, so what we've done, really, if you think about it, we've actually looked, and Ganesh, the goal of Ganesh's exercise really was to understand the scale of the problem that we need to be able to design in that robustness and that fail-safe. So, but what we really want to do is start using generative design type tools. As Tony mentioned, being able to get the system to help us go through design iterations and come up with an optimum solution. So what we'd like to do, I'd like to introduce Paul Bevan now, and we're going to take you through taking what Ganesh found, which was the load conditions. How can we redesign that bell crank very quickly to give us a new solution? So if we can just change to the... Okay, when we're going to start this, Paul is actually inside, he's been given his task, he's inside of NX, but he's using Active Workspace inside of NX. And the beauty of using Active Workspace inside of NX is that he doesn't have to leave the design environment to access all the information, all the issue information, all the affected items. Once you've raised the issue, he can navigate through, find the things he needs to work on, get to his task, the task that he has to do. So he's going to load up this the bookmark, the assembly. He's been given a task to investigate these parts and see if he can come up with a better design. So we've actually got, so this is kind of maybe much clearer to you to see that yellow bell crank that we were looking at, and we were thinking about how we can analyze it. We're going to isolate it, but we're going to use generative approaches to designing the new part. So what Paul's done is he's really decomposed the key parts of the design. He's extracted from this, he's said, okay, here is the volume that I want this thing to fit inside, and here are some areas that I want, that I know I have to have clear. And that's what he's got, a very base level building block. And he's also got is the pivot points. The pivot points are key, they can't really move. We've already positioned that, so we know that. But what he's also now doing is he's putting the load cases on that Ganesh found, transferring those into the optimization to go through. Now, once we go through this, this is going to be a fairly coarse first pass approach. We're using topology optimization tools to go through and generate design. We're having the system do a lot of thinking for us. It's running through a number of cycles, and you can start seeing this kind of nice map as it's going through the process of running multiple solutions, as many millions of potential solutions to how we could redesign that part to get the weight, a sensible weight, and also to manage those load conditions. So we're going to redesign that, come up with a new shape that we can work with. And then we're going to take that. Now, the beauty of this, as Tony mentioned earlier, is as we work through this, we're generating this design, which I promise you will be it's an interesting shape. But with the power of generative design, convergent technologies, and convergent modeling technology to be able to work with this type of facet data, not having to do conversion. Anyone that's done topology optimization type tools in the past using other tools, you'll find that that data then is a rough guide. You've got facet data. We can use that directly because we've got convergent modeling inside of NX. And now you can start seeing the load cases and the design that the systems come up with. So we're just going to swap it out back out in the assembly just quickly. Yep. And then we'll just show you how that fits in nicely in the assembly, and you'll get a sense for how this all comes together. It's overlaying the yellow part, so we'll just go out and do that. It's a simple assembly function. And now you can see this connection of how this will all tie together. So we've actually got that in process, and then we can start working with that. Okay, thanks, Paul. So the whole idea of having this generative design type capacity is to give you ways of exploring more solutions and coming up with truly amazing results. Now, as Bill mentioned earlier, and as was mentioned, that this is only part of an overall system, and it has interaction amongst other parts of the system. So I'm going to hand over back to Bill, and Bill will take you through how we can manage the system inputs and the controls.
Thanks, Paul. So we did the mechanical corrective action. Now it's time to smarten up the system. And what we want to do is introduce a number of sensors that'll help us accomplish a lot of different things. We're going to introduce an optical sensor to see if we have that obstruction. We're also going to introduce some accelerometers, because while we're at it, while we're smartening this up, why don't we do some condition-based maintenance? So we'll monitor the wear and tear on that landing gear and bring it out of service only when it needs to be, rather than at the predefined schedules that we currently do. So why don't we walk through the steps that's going to do that for us. Now, the way we're going to do that is apply some systems engineering thinking. First step we need to do is figure out exactly what it is this smart product needs to do. What behavior do we expect? What requirements is it supposed to meet, and so on. Then we need to come up with the implementation strategy, or how are we going to do it? It's probably going to be some combination of electrical and software and mechanical working together. And then, like I mentioned earlier, closing the loop. Prove that the product is doing what we expect it to do, but plan how we're going to prove it up front. So we're going to come over to a demonstration with Ron, and Ron's going to show us how we do some of this in Teamcenter. So what we're looking at here in Teamcenter to start out with is a list of requirement specifications for this particular aircraft. Now, not all of these requirement specifications are created equal. Some of these are regulatory requirements. These are things that we have to meet. We don't have any negotiation or wiggle room or anything like that. Other requirements might have a little more flexibility, like performance requirements or customer requirements and so on. And as we go from a high-level system view, like we're looking at here, and drill down into the systems and subsystems and components that are going to deliver this, we're going to start to hit that implementation strategy. We're going to find requirements that we know are going to be delivered by software or by electrical. So in this case, we've got a whole series of performance management requirements that the software is going to implement, and we want to go ahead and add another one. So in this case, we're going to create a requirement that is for the overall application of the software. In this case, we're going to tell it, you know, we want you to collect and filter information from the sensors. We're not going to tell it how to do that. That's going to be for the software guys to figure out. But we know from a systems view that this is what the software needs to deliver. And when we get downstream to software, we'll show you how they decompose that. But that gives us a requirement that we can send over to the software space. Now, like I talked about, this is a multi-domain implementation. The software needs to know about the hardware. So in this case, we're going to attach a technical spec of the accelerometer. So the software people will have what signals are coming out of that accelerometer, what inputs and outputs does that accelerometer give us. So we'll attach that and give that to the software people too. So now that we have the what, or the requirements defined of what this smart product is supposed to do, let's talk a little bit about the system of systems. How is this whole thing supposed to interact? So I know you can't read it, don't try to read it. What we're looking at here is a kind of a big picture of how this landing gear fits within all the other systems within the plane. Of course, we've narrowed it down a little bit to try to get to the scope we want to talk about. And you'll see a lot of different types of information on this diagram. You'll see requirements. So these are some of those requirements that we talked about in the previous step. You're going to see functions. So what function does the product need to perform to deliver that requirement? And you'll see that that's related to those requirements. So we have traceability there. How are we going to implement those functions? So what's the logical breakdown of this? And even what's the physical part that's going to deliver that function? All that is modeled up here, and we're understanding how it all relates to each other. Now, we've already done a little bit of the work. We've added the optical sensor. We've added one of the accelerometers up at the top by the fuselage. We're going to add another one now down by the wheel. So what you see here is we add another logical block that represents that accelerometer, that other sensor. Now, like I said, this is a system of systems, and these things need to communicate to each other. So there's a lot of different ways that we can have this sensor interface with the product. One of the ways it can interface with the product is a mechanical connection. You know, we're going to mount this sensor to this particular post or something like that. There may be an energy connection that we need to manage. In this case, we also want to manage the information coming out of that sensor. So what we just did was link that sensor up to the control module, where eventually, someday, the electronics and software is going to reside. But now we have a connection between those things. We can then go and start to identify the types of information that will flow over that connection. So what signals are going to come out of that sensor, and where are they going to go, and how do we need to manage them? So we can add the type of information that will flow that we can then use downstream as we're developing the multi-domain strategy to implement this. So once we've got all this documented, you know, we have this big picture that tells us the requirements and the functions that we're going to perform and how we're going to do it and the interfaces and all that stuff. The next thing we want to be able to do is start to figure out how we're going to test and prove it. So what you're looking at here is kind of a list of some of the tests that we've created. You know, we want to validate this set of requirements with this test and this set of requirements with this test. And we're going to go ahead and create another one of these so you can see what goes into it. Now, we call these analysis requests. And what it's going to do is it's going to take a look at this big picture diagram that we've got with all this information. And depending on the type of analysis that we want it to do, it's going to filter out some of that information that's not relevant and include the information that is important to the simulation that we need to perform. So it'll take in some of the logical blocks and the functions. It'll take in some of the interface definitions. And perhaps most importantly, it's going to take in the requirements. So it's going to document all those things in this package. So you can kind of see here all those things that's required to perform a simulation that's going to validate those requirements that you see on that list. Even gives us a placeholder for the output. So once that simulation is done, we can capture the results and we can come back and review that. And if we need to make changes, rerun it, we can do all that because it's all captured and all kept track of. So if we come back to the PowerPoint slides, thanks, Ron. So we were able to deploy some systems engineering thinking up front early in the process and avoid problems before they occur because we're able to anticipate them, build our corrective actions, and find strategies that are going to avoid those problems.
So Bill, if I may just interrupt for a second, I wanted to ask Alan on some of the systems design work and early aircraft requirements definitions. How do you do that today, and what do you see as an application for this kind of technology in the future?
Well, what you're describing is exactly the way we have to do it from a systems approach. You have, obviously, the FAA requirements, which are sometimes very prescriptive, and we'll build out of that a set of compliance checklists. This is what we have to do. This is how we show conformity. This is what the airplane must be. And that has to be balanced against what we'll call market requirements and objectives. So this is what the airplane needs to be to get to the customer to do it right. Canada, the next version of the Eclipse, has a requirement to have a 1,400 nautical mile cruise range at max cruise. So then you balance these through a system of design, analysis, and iteration. But the interesting part about what you get when you document it this way is that then you've got the ability to adapt to changes. So for example, the FAA has just simplified some of the Part 23 rules, the rules under which we design airplanes, to remove a lot of requirements. They've added a few, but they've removed a lot of requirements. So all of a sudden, it opens up a lot of new possibilities for us. So you go back to the requirements document again, and you need to know why you did it in the first place, capture the changes that you made because of that, and then work forward from there. In the case of the original Eclipse aircraft, there was a hard requirement of 6,000 pound gross weight. 6,001 meant you had to meet a different set of rules. So everything was really driven on weight. With Canada at 6,900 pounds, we blow through the rule, and fortunately the rule just went away. So you end up with a completely different set of requirements to design to.
Sure.
So,
thank you. Right.
Thank you. So now that we've done some planning, let's get into the multi-domain implementation of this. The first place we're going to go is electronics, and for that I'm going to bring Paul back up.
Okay. Thanks, Bill. So, as Bill said, when we're looking at solving this problem, we also want to add some extra intelligence into the solution by adding some extra sensors, a couple of accelerometers, and also an optical sensor, which would actually sense if the door is not closed properly. So what we're looking at doing is integrating the different domains, the mechanical domain, the electronic domain, and the electrical domain. And we're going to take you through some examples, and it was great when both Tony and Martin mentioned earlier about the integration we've done already with the Mentor products. So what you can see here for now is that this is Mentor XDX. It's a schematic layout for the PCB. And we're feeding that back into Teamcenter, and inside of Teamcenter, you can see the entire bill of material for the PCB. The PCB will actually control and monitor the sensors and collect the information, because what we really want to do is keep records of in service to see how this behavior. Now, at the same time as the PCB designers are working on the schematic and the design, the mechanical design team can sit there, can start working on things like the enclosure and the board layout and the actual board space. And we pass that backwards and forwards between NX and the Mentor tools, and we go through and actually bring this in into XPCB. And now you can start seeing the profile. And one of the really neat things about Mentor and the XPCB product and the VX product is that you can actually look at the board in 3D layout and start to understand the space allocations and the needs that you have in the electrical system. But once again, tying this back together into with NX, and we're going through and managing this all inside of Teamcenter, being able to compare schematic, cross-probe between schematic and the board layout, go and look at find all the information, make sure everything is accounted for. And then we're passing that back into inside of NX to get the 3D outline, which we can package around. It can adjust our packaging and our board layout, bringing the material together. But one important thing is this is all interconnected. So if we then go back and change any situation. So in this case, we're back in Mentor, and we're looking at changing, because we need access to this little card slot. And so we're going to move this around. We've spun that around, and we've actually moved the connection board over. And now what we can do inside of NX is update our layout. So all the time, this close interconnection between the PCB solutions and the 3D model to allow us to package this and get this as part of the design. You can start seeing the changes being tracked and the new board layout, so we can make sure that we validate this and it all fits on the board profile that was allocated in the space for the design. Now, We're not going to take you through positioning this little control box on the aircraft. That's just regular assemblies inside of NX. If anyone wants to learn how to do that, I'm sure there must be a training class in here somewhere in this session which will show you how to do that. So we won't worry about that. Just accept to us, we've put the box inside the aircraft. And now we're going to look at the next part. And once again, Martin mentioned this idea of connecting capital harness with NX. And what you see are, you can actually see the two versions of the schematic diagram for the harness, the current, and with our new sensors in, the two accelerometers in, and the optical sensor. Now, inside the harness on the NX side, you'll notice that everything has a green tick. It means that every wire is connected, all of the components are placed. But we're now going to connect Mentor, the capital, to NX, and we're going to drive this connection between the two systems. And you can actually now start seeing that we've actually got a few stop signals. These are set parts that have not been placed physically in the harness. We know they belong. We've been told by the schematic that we need those parts, but they've not yet been placed or been connected. One neat thing about the whole connection is that you can cross-probe. We can pick in capital harness, and you can see it highlighting in the 3D model. You can pick in the 3D model, and you can see it where it fits in the schematic. Tying that closely together, allowing you to get that multi-discipline interaction to find out exactly where the wires are, connections, where everything is tied together, giving you much richer information. So we've gone through and we've actually allocated, we've got these unallocated objects. So what we want to do now is go through and modify the harness to include those extra, place those parts. The part navigator has been populated with the right components because we got the information from the schematic, from capital harness, to tell us which parts needed to be placed. And all we're now going to do is place those parts into the 3D assembly. So we're going to position those on the model. We're going to put them on the trunnion. You'll see the two connectors. And there's one on our PCB box that we brought in that I said we wouldn't show you, worry about how we position this. So now what we're doing is running the harness, but all we're looking at the moment is a space allocation, which is the rough harness size. We've not gone and started doing the wire connections. We're just routing the cable as a space allocation to give us some areas through these clamp points and trying to make sure that we get some nice bends and transitions into this to connect everything together. So you'll start seeing how we connect that up. And of course, we're just adjusting to get a good bend radii inside the cable run. Once we've done that, we can start generating the cable runs themselves. And we're pulling the information in from the wire bundles, what's connected to what, which has come from capital. And you'll see that the cables have actually adjusted in size because that's the size we need for the correct harness. We have one last thing we're going to add to this, is a little bit of overstock around this area. Because it's running past our green box, we're going to put a toughened sleeve around that cable, just to make sure that as the mechanism moves, if there is any rub, it's not going to rub through the cable. So now you've got the finished harness. But, of course, we now need to manufacture that. And one of the things that that Martin said earlier was talking about how this gets manufactured. So once again, we have the connection between capital and NX, and it works both ways. So now what we're going to do is take our harness, and on this side you can see the form board layout of the harness with its fittings. And what we're doing is going to drive this through and pass this information back. We've got the 3D model, and we're unfolding that and flattening that out to be manufactured in the plants that we have available to us with the manufacturing capabilities and the rules that our manufacturing systems know. And you can see the change process going through. We're just going through and regenerating the change. And there you go, new components, new pin lists, all the information you need for that to manufacture that harness and get the correct layout for the harness to go inside the aircraft. So the value of that is it really can break down the barriers between disciplines, and it allows you to deliver your products with confidence.
So, Alan, maybe just a quick comment on this, and if you could provide some insight from One Aviation's perspective. What is the content of electrical and electronics systems, maybe compared to the Eclipse, to the Canada? And then what do you, how do you envision leveraging these types of tools across the different systems of electronics and mechanical and the routed systems that go in between?
Yep. So first, just briefly on history, the Eclipse, when it was first done, was the most automated sensor-equipped airplane of its size, and probably much more so than even a lot of larger airplanes that you might be familiar with. So it was controlled through dual redundant aircraft computer systems that look at a lot of sensors and manage the airplane. If you think more broadly at aviation, pilots in the beginning were data collectors. They had to know everything. That changed into system managers, where a lot of the automation in the airplane did things for them, and they needed to understand partly how it was done and what to do about it. In the long run, pilots will be decision makers, that the automation will take care of a lot of things, and they'll say, here's where I want to go, not here's how I get there. And that's on this path towards autonomous airplanes and autonomous vehicles and all of that. It requires more and more integration of the systems. Confidence, of course, is the key word. Do you trust it all? As we go towards Canada, we'll see more of that, first in terms of flight envelope protection. Again, how does the pilot not get himself into trouble? So you've got the manipulation of the controls, you've got the collection of data, you've got sensors and systems managing the flight, but then you'll also have systems operating in the background that will limit what the pilot can do without consciously overriding them. So all of this is on that continuum towards automation.
Okay, Paul?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Alan.
So, well, you've seen it. We've now gone through, we've got mechanical fixes, we've added the harness. So now let's look at how we're going to develop the software and the software controls for the smart system.
All right, thanks, Paul. All right, so the software. Let's talk about software. Software these days, what we see with a lot of our customers is they have kind of separate life cycles with hardware and software, and they have planned touch points, integration points. You know, we'll get together every 2 weeks, we'll get together every month and do a hardware-software integration activity. And since the last time we got together, hardware specs have changed or requirements are different, so now we've got to go rework something in software. What we want to achieve is that we don't have those separate life cycles with touch points every now and then. We want one unified life cycle to make sure that information and decisions are understood by everybody on all sides of these fences. So let's take a quick look here at another demonstration. What we're looking at here is one of those requirements that we saw previously when we were planning the whole smart system. This was one of the requirements that we were going to delegate to software, that we want software to fulfill. So what we can do is working inside Teamcenter, because we have a federated data model and we can do things like delegated user interfaces and that kind of a thing, we can create a requirement on the software end in Polarian, in the ALM tool. And so what this is we're creating a requirement inside Polarian that we want to be the touch point, that we want to pass the requirement into for the software lifecycle. So that's what we see here in this window is that Polarian requirement. So they're going to create this requirement that the application shall provide, you know, sensor monitoring and eventually is going to filter the information and so on. And now that we've got that requirement created on the Polarian side, we can very quickly create a relationship between these two things, from the Teamcenter side to the Polarian side. This requirement in Polarian is decomposing the requirement in Teamcenter, or it's elaborating the requirement in Teamcenter, or other types of relationships. So now here in Teamcenter, at the bottom, we see that link that is a federated data model that allows that data to live in Polarian without having to replicate it in Teamcenter or vice versa. So now we come into Polarian. Now we're the software guy looking at the software world, and he sees that requirement that we just created for him, and he's going to place it into his software spec where he wants it to be. So he just moved it up in this document view, And now he's going to decompose it even further. So we just told him, provide sensor monitoring data. He's going to go say, I need to get the x-axis displacement, and the y-axis, the z-axis. I need to store that data somewhere. I need to be able to recall that data, and so on. So all those specific software requirements that they're going to implement to achieve this particular function, he can create here. So now that we've got these requirements managed in ALM, we can link that to other portions of the software development lifecycle. So for instance, the build. What's the real official software binary that's going to go on this product and link it to the requirements? What about the test plan? And how are we going to prove this software? And who's going to do it? So here we can create a task that we're going to assign somebody to validate that software. Then we're going to run a bunch of tests and see what kind of test coverage we've got. So here we are with the dashboard that shows us how well we're doing with the software. Are we testing it? Are we passing or are we failing? We can take a look closer at any particular test run, find out more information about it, and so on. So here we have all the information, starting with that requirement, traceable to all these other things downstream in software. They're going to help us prove the software works when it comes time to get certified and so on. And then, because we're doing this in this unified environment, we're going to go back into Teamcenter. And this is Teamcenter's relation browser. And the blue objects that you see on the top, these are the Teamcenter requirements. These are what we've been decomposing from the system, subsystem, and so on. And that yellow one is the one that we started off in Polarian. And if we expand that, we're going to see the software requirements underneath that. All right, yeah. Thought it froze up, maybe. So here we see the Polarian requirement. So you've got Teamcenter in blue on the top, Polarian in yellow on the bottom, or left and right, because we're about to change it. But we've got traceability across this whole structure, even though the data comes in different systems. So now we have the visibility on both ends. So as things are changing in one discipline or the other, we can go back and double check and make sure things continue to work at any time, not just at those predefined touch points. So now we know the product works because we start integrated, and throughout the process, we stay integrated. All right, the last section. What we want to do is we prove the product performs the way we expect it to perform. So we've done a lot of great work around planning the smart product. We've done a lot of multi-domain implementation from electronics to mechanical to software. Now we want to leverage all that stuff. We've built up a lot of knowledge, and we want to be able to leverage all that to make sure the product behaves and performs the way we expect it to. So the first thing that we're going to see here is a report. And I love this report. What this report is showing is, remember those tests that we put together, that test plan with the analysis request? Well, across the top, you see milestone by milestone how many tests we've run and which ones are passing and failing. And on the table on the bottom, you see the explicit requirements that are being validated and are they passing or not. If we dive down in and get a little more detail, we can see specifically about what's happening in a particular test and, again, what requirements are being validated and proven, making it very easy to understand throughout that life cycle what we're doing and are we achieving what we expect to achieve. But what we've got here is that simulation that we saw up in the beginning of the demonstration that had the 3D motion that showed how we had that collision and that jam condition. But this time what we're doing is we're putting 1D in here to manage the behavior. We're defining what the control strategy is for this landing gear with the 1D model. And oh, by the way, we're also putting the pilot in the loop with the virtual flight simulator. So tying all these things together, and you watch what's going to happen with the control strategy, we get to our collision, and we've told it, you know what, we don't want that condition. You better open back up. And it opens back up and notifies the pilot in the flight simulator, because that's one of the requirements that we have, is to make sure the pilot knows what's going on. So we're closing the loop. We're using all that information that we've built up over the development process to get the information we need to prove the product works the way that we expect it to. So closing the loop, using the digital twin to develop a smart product.
Okay. Well, Bill, thank you very much, and Paul and the whole team. I really appreciate it, the whole walkthrough that we've done.